certainly great to be back here, and certainly have a lot of fond memories of my time here, I guess. That's probably been, I don't know, 15 years since I was here last, I think. Quite a while ago, but anyway, so it's nice to be back once more after.
Better than after the mind, some of us.
Yeah, that's right. So it's good to see some familiar faces, and anyway, so. Yeah, so I did get under this area of quantum control, I guess. And it was probably not a direct influence from John, but maybe an indirect one. So I remember, one of the things I remember about being a student of John's is that we had lots of conversations that were very stimulating and not necessarily directly related to my thesis and particular papers that we were writing, but just generally in terms of, you know, the level of excitement that he had about science and engineering, and that kind of rocked off under me. Anyway, so I ended up starting to do the quantum stuff. Probably in the late 90s, I started to become aware of things that were happening in quantum computing, and I became aware that some people were trying to do some work in control in the physics community. And so I remember when I was in Cambridge, in England, on a sabbatical, I started to, you know, get some quantum textbooks and read them on the train when I was going to London. Like that. So it's been a long journey to get back into it. So what I'll talk about today, I guess, is some work which follows a theme of ours for the last 5 or 10 years, which relates to dealing with photons themselves. And it's been a great pleasure to work with a number of really fabulous collaborators. So I'd like to acknowledge that. Yeah. So I want to talk about a range of things, I guess. So first of all, I'll give you a bit of background. So it's usually the case that when I give talks that, you know, in engineering or math, that most people don't have the background in the physics, right? And so I usually have to remind, or not properly remind, but at least, you know, give you some context, I guess, to start with. And then I'll walk you through some calculations to do with absorption and emissions of photons. And, you know, talk about applications in quantum memories and then the transformations of wave packet shapes and things like that. And then I'll conclude, hopefully with enough time, on filtering theory for single photon systems. Okay. So, as you probably know, the photon is the basic unit of light, I guess. And so there are lots of applications in quantum technology. So they're used, for example, for medium in quantum communications, for example. You know, there are lots of technologies for sensors, which can detect, you know, single photon arrival events and things like that. And photons have a very long history, so there's a theory of spontaneous and stimulated emission going back to Einstein in the early 20th century, I guess, 1905 or somewhere around about then. So he's a very famous work where he developed his great equations. And so there, you know, if you have an atom sitting in an ambient field, I guess, and it's got some excitation, then at some random time, a photon will be emitted. And so we can understand these things these days with much more modern mathematical machinery. And I guess you'll see a bit of that during this talk. So, so mathematically we can create a photon from the vacuum through what in physics called the creation operator. So that's this B star over here, and the zero on the right hand side there refers to the vacuum. And the XC here is a function which is going to be the pulse shape, which is sort of like a bell shape, for example. And so the photon in general is going to have some spatial extent or extent as it's traveling through space. And so I guess the main thing of this talk then is being able to sort of understand these pulse shapes and how to change them and manipulate them and how they're transformed by systems and things like that. Okay. So the photon field is really quite different to a Gaussian field. So Gaussian fields are used to describe coherent light, but single photon fields are fundamentally different for this distance. So as I mentioned here on the slide, they have zero meaning, but they have an intensity. So this, this star B represents what's called the number operator, and it gives us, in a sense, the intensity of the field at that particular time. And so it gives the square of this wave packet shape, as you can see. So it gives you the probability of detection per unit of time. Okay. So a very basic problem in physics is the scattering problem. When you shine light or other particles onto a physical system, how do they get scattered? And so one of the things that we're interested in is how a system can actually transform and change the shape of the pulses. Okay. So one basic example, and you can imagine a photon hitting a beam splitter. So a beam splitter is a mirror that's partly silvered, and so the light can either go through or be reflected. And so at this kind of very discrete level, the photon can either just bounce backwards or pass through, if you think of it in those sort of particle terms. And so one of the sort of calculational problems, I guess, is to determine exactly what is the nature of the output field. Okay, so one of the reasons why the pulse shapes are very important is because if you want to shine light that maybe contains some information onto a memory system, for example, we'd like that photon energy to be perfectly absorbed. Okay? So the pulse shape is really important for that perfect absorption. And so one of the things that I'll talk about today is the idea of quantum memory, which makes use of these wave packet shapes to address various locations inside the memory. So another extremely important problem in physics, experimental physics, is the creation of photons on demand. So it's easy to create photons, but it's not so easy to create them exactly when you want them. So that's a major technical problem. So you need to have the precise timing of the photons. That's quite a substantial technical challenge, experimentally. So I'll talk a bit about that and how you can also shape the wave packets.
Okay.
When
you say exact timing, you're talking
microseconds? Yeah, or even higher than that. Yeah. Yeah. So I'll say more about that as you go through the talk. Yeah. Okay. So, so another problem is if you are trying to probe a system using photons, and then you're using the light that comes out of the system, how do you make some inferences about what the system is doing on the basis of that photon field, the output field? So that's a basic problem of filtering. And so that becomes a bit more complicated when you have a field in a single photon state. And we'll show you how that works. Okay. So, I'm sure you're aware of the basic history of quantum mechanics, I guess. I won't go through all that, of course, but I want to say that the main kind of intellectual framework that we've adopted is one of quantum probability. Okay. So, you know, quantum physics has had a long and interesting history over the past century or more, and there's lots of ways of viewing and interpreting it, and it's a topic of philosophical discussion and all of that. But what we want to do, the engineering that we are familiar with, then it's very natural to work in a probabilistic framework, a non-community probabilistic framework. Okay. And so I guess the original axiomatization was done by von Neumann, I guess, in the 40s or early 50s or thereabouts. It was right at the same time that classical probability was axiomatized by Kolmogorov, I guess. I think his work actually predates Kolmogorov. But that's another interesting point, is that in the early days of quantum mechanics, which is really a statistical or probabilistic theory, the tools weren't all that well developed at the time. Okay, the tools are much better developed now. a legacy of that in the way that people approach quantum physics. Okay, so if you go to a typical physics course, like the one I did as an undergraduate many years ago, then you learn about non-commuting observables, and you learn about calculating expectations of the position and momentum using the wave function. You learn about the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, and you learn about the Schrodinger equation, and do lots of calculations, right? But that's not very... I mean, all of these things become kind of special cases of, you know, the more general framework of quantum probability, right? But approaching quantum control using equations like these is going to be very far. So you have to interpret what these things mean in a much bigger framework. Okay, so in particular, we need to work with open quantum systems. So what we mean by that is a system of interest, in this case the atom, but it's an atom that's interacting with an external environment, an open system. Okay? And so, I guess what we need to have is the dynamical models that capture that open system behavior. So what's an example of an open system? So one of the, I've already seen an atom as being an example of an open system, but another concrete example in the laboratory is a cavity, an optical cavity. So optical cavity is nothing more than the physical space between two mirrors. And you can think of a standing wave of light supported between those two mirrors. The mirrors can have, you know, can have, it can be partly silver so that some of the light gets reflected and some of it passes through, and so it's an open system. Okay. And so in this picture here, this is the optics table of my colleague Eleanor Huntington, who's now the Dean of Engineering and Computer Science at ANU. But in her lab, she's got a laser, which is basically shining light onto the cavity, and then I guess light can also bounce off one of those mirrors. Okay, that's an example of an open system. And the nice thing about these kinds of systems is that they have a linear evolution, which makes them very practical, and so we'll make use of that quite a bit. Okay, so quantum fields. So quantum fields are used to describe things like light. So you can think about quantum fields as being like infinitely many oscillators, oscillating up and down. And you can think about that in the time domain, or in the spatial domain, or in the frequency domain. And they satisfy a commutation relation. It's called the canonical commutation relation. So the square bracket notation then means that the commutator, you know, AB minus BA, and that's delta correlated in this idealized framework. Okay. And so that singular nature leads to a quantum stochastic representation. It's a bit like what we do in when we have a Wiener process or Eta calculus. So all of that has generalizations in quantum context. I'll say a few words about that. So in particular, we have an Eta product rule, for example, that product of dB and its adjoint, the star here and its adjoint is dT. So at the back end, all the other Eta products, because you know these terms don't commute necessarily, that will be zero. Okay. So we like to specify open quantum systems by a triple, SLH. And so these parameters are quantities like Hamiltonian H, which determine the underlying unitary evolution for the full system, the system plus the environment. Okay, that's written in terms of this quantum stochastic differential equation. So the H here is the Hamiltonian, so that's capturing the internal self-energy of the system. L is an operator which describes how the system is coupled to the external field. And S, in general, is a unitary matrix which determines any scattering in the system. Okay. so I can just say S3 and S3 is the equation. And so this equation was first developed by Hudson and Pansari in the early 80s. So the mathematical physicist's based in the UK.
And by Evans.
Sorry?
And by Evans.
Sorry?
Book on modern time system. And that's in there.
Yes, but he didn't have the quantitative calculus. So I'm talking about a particular quantitative theory. So there were lots of people doing work on open quantum systems going back to the early 70s. But there was no stochastic calculus actually.
He didn't have stochastic calculus, but he did have a point process.
Yeah.
Because he was working specifically on photons.
That's right. Okay.
And they had an equation similar to that, but they were not in terms of many processes, it was more like along the line of point process.
That's right. Okay. So the way that systems can evolve in time, so X here represents an operator of the physical system, you can think of it as being energy or position or momentum or something like that. And so the general evolution in the Heisenberg picture is you sandwich X between the adjoint and the unitary operator cube. Okay. And we also have the output field, and that's also given by sandwiching the input field.
What is U here?
So U here is the unitary solution to the
operator
equation. Yeah. So the overall full system evolves unitarily, but the system of interest does not evolve unitarily.
There's nothing back there.
No, this is just the basic physics. Okay. So you can write down the equations for these evolutions, and it kind of looks very much like a diffusion equation, like a non-commutative diffusion equation. And also we can write down an output equation. So for example, if we were using a homodyne detector as a measurement device, that basically projects onto a quadrature. So it's like looking at the real part of a complex number. And Y here is a signal that gets produced at the output of that detector.
You may want to remind people what homodyne is.
Yeah, so all you need to know about homodyne is that it's taking the field B and adding it to its conjugate. So just looking at the real part. But down a bit lower, it's
not good. Go lower in terms of the graduate and then what is classical on that?
So,
because it's a very well known technique in
that's
in
right.
Case, right?
That's right. Okay, so given the a measurement signal like that, so the other kind of measurement signal, of course, is just to have a photo detector by itself. And one of the things that we'd like to do is to make statistical inferences about what the system is doing on the basis of the measurement information, the standard thing that we all know about, right? And so the framework for that is a conditional expectation. But a conditional expectation works in the quantum context, so we're projecting onto a subspace, but we need to have a technical condition that the subspace that you're projecting onto is in some sense compatible with the thing that you're trying to project. So there's like a consistency condition. Okay. So the way in which we can think about the measurement theory is by using a probe device. So the probe device is effectively the optical field. So information about the system gets transferred to the field. So we don't measure the system directly, but we measure the system through looking at the photons that get scattered, right? Okay, and so the projection postulate and all the different versions of quantum measurement theory are all special cases of this kind of general system probe conditional expectation. Okay, so I guess Colloquium had the most general results about this. Colloquium was a Russian mathematical physicist who unfortunately passed away about 5 years ago. But he was was a student of Stefanovich in Moscow. And I guess John would have known him in the 30s probably.
Okay.
So he's a very nice guy. I had lots of great conversations with him. But anyway, he had the Holo was another one of the Russian people at the time. But he developed this this filtering theory. I guess there was a whole sequence of papers that, that he published.
Last year or the year before, he gave the Sanon lecture at the International Symposium on Information Theory, exactly honoring his work on, was the first to completely mathematize quantum information.
Yes, I think Holloway made the contributions to information theory.
But he was a student of Colloquium. But you went the other way.
You went the other way. Whereas Alaskan was a student of Stefanovich and did the stochastic theory, the filtering theory. Right? Yeah. But it looks very much like a normal nonlinear filtering equation, right?
But this is the analog of the Zakai equation, right?
Yeah, that's the analog of the.
So that you can collect it in the genome.
That's right. And so, so this is a, you know, part of the quantum probability framework that's good for people like us. So if we go back to the cavity case, and it's an example of an open quantum harmonic oscillator, and the evolution equations for that turn out to be very nice and simple, it's just a linear evolution. So A here is the what's called the annihilation operator for that system, and it evolves according to this very simple linear equation driven by the input field, okay? And it has a, it also satisfies these computation relations. Okay. And the output field, you know, just looks like a normal output equation, right? It's got better sort of direct feed through to them. Okay. All right. So I mentioned before when we were talking about the measurement, that we can get the looking at field plus its conjugate, that's like looking at the real part of the complex number. We can also look at the imaginary part or indeed any other phase. And so we can produce a whole lot of different kinds of measurements. And the important point here is that, for example, this one here is the imaginary part, so P and Q in general don't commute. Right? So, but on the other hand, Q is commutes with itself at different times, and P commutes with itself at different times, but the commutator between them is different. And so what you have within the one quantum field is that you have a whole infinite collection, really, of incompatible quinar processors. So when the system is driven in by the vacuum, then both the Q and the P will be quinar processors, but they're incompatible. They don't,
yeah.
Okay, so you can't measure them at the same time.
There is an analog in classical communications when you try to time and frequency at the same time.
That's right.
Okay, so that's why you let them, you try to connect the things that you may know.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Okay. All right, so the way that we like to write equations more generally is that we stack the annihilation and creation operators on top of each other. And so these, in general, could be multivariables. You could have multiple channels. And so that's just the notation that we've come to use over the years. So it's like an ABCD linear system, except the quantities that you're working with are no longer, you know, real numbers or complex numbers, but they're the operators in context. So matrices A, B, and S here, in general, are going to be complex matrices. You can rewrite these things in quadrature form using the Q's, and there the matrices will all be real matrices. Okay. So not any system of this form is going to correspond to something that's physical. So mathematically they make sense, but they don't necessarily make sense physically unless the matrices satisfy some constraints.
I just want to make a remark at this. In this area, understanding the connection between dynamics and physics or the dynamics, I emphasize is extremely important.
Yeah.
While in most control theory after the 70s, people have forgotten the definition. In your times, people paid attention to dynamics and whether the underlying circuit is, you know, capacity or distributed or whatever. This was forgotten.
Yeah.
Central digitization. But in this area, this is a beautiful
example
where we have to understand the structure of the system and understand them.
In fact, that comment still applies today, because there's a lot of work in quantum information at the discrete digital level,
right.
But they're missing this whole layer of essentially analog physics. So the experimentalists are very familiar with analog physics, they're going to deal with it in their laboratories. There's a lot of theoretical work that's just at this kind of more abstract level, which is really important, but there's kind of this missing gap. And that's kind of where, that's kind of the space that we're working.
It's a distinct departure from classical communication, because we faced it when I was working back in the 70s, that you always have to worry about the realization of momentum.
Oh, absolutely.
You do the math, but yeah. Then you have to ask, okay, this is the result.
Yeah.
Do I have a physical device that corresponds to this?
That's right.
This is what you are looking
for. Yeah, that's a physical realization, that's right. And if you take, you know, transforms, then you have transfer functions, and the transfer function has a particular form and satisfies what we call a metrology condition, which is another way of sort of characterizing that physical probability. Okay. We can have Gaussian states and fields, as I mentioned, as well as the photon ones. Okay, so now let's start looking a bit more closely at photons themselves. But what I've done so far, really, just to give you, a little overview that was way too short, I'm sure, but anyway. So what we're going to consider is a cavity driven by a field in a single photon state, and just to see what happens to that. So one of the nice things about first order linear equations is that I think we can all solve them, right? Variation constant, right? And so one of the things that we're going to look at now is how does the number operator behave? What's its average value going to be? Okay. What we're trying to do is we're trying to ask the question, well, if I've got an input field in a photon shape, how does that photon get transferred to the system? Okay. So the way in which we do that is just to multiply the annihilation operator A by the state of the system. So zero here talks about the ground state of the cavity, so it's like an empty cavity to start with. And the field state is indicated by this this photon notation. Okay. So if you go through and look at the calculations here, what I want to draw your attention to is that we end up getting two integrals. So there's an integral that describes the creation of the photons, remember? There's an integral describing the convolution, right? But the field also has some commutation relations, right? So here we've got a B times B star, we swap them around, and we get B star B, and then we get the delta function. Okay? So the B acting on the vacuum, I mean, it's kind of split up the shape, unfortunately, turns out to be zero. And that's why we've got a zero here, because that acting on that is zero. And so what we end up with is a sort of convolutional relationship. So at least this part in the calculation is going to have this convolution. So the general way in which a system like a cavity is going to act on the wavelength shape is just through our very familiar convolutions.
What's the zero sub A? Is it the zero sub
A? So here I was kind of emphasize that this relates to the system,
okay.
And this relates to the field. Yeah, so I wasn't quite consistent enough in that, but that's what the intent was. Okay.
So this is like a transfer product?
Yes.
Matrices in gas?
Yes. Yeah, so you have a
system to get that evolution.
That's right, so you need to form a tensor product for the system and the field together. Okay. So far we've just done a calculation, we've got a convolution. So now I'm going to assume that the wave packet has a particular form, namely this tuned rising exponential. Okay. Rising in the magnitude. And if you make that assumption and just go through a little bit of compilation, if we let the initial time go to minus infinity, and set the final time to be time zero, the present, then we find that the average value of the number operator is one. So it's telling us when we have this very special wave packet shape that we get perfect absorption. So the cavity itself will now contain exactly one photon. So if the wave packet shape were not perfectly tuned, then you would not get perfect absorption. Okay. Another way to see this is if you think about the transfer function. The transfer function is an all-pass transfer function. So it's a pair of symmetric pair of poles and zeros. So basically the rising exponential corresponds to exciting the system at a zero. Okay. And so, as you can see, we just don't have any good Laplace transform. Okay. So we're predicting Laplace transform to reduce some of the tests. Okay, so now we might want to also calculate the output field and that will result. So we can think about that as happening in the future. And so there, what we find is that the output is zero. While it's being absorbed, when the absorption is finished, then it will get emitted. And so we get an output shape being produced. So that's the emission stage. So we've done absorption and emission. Okay. All right. So now there's a very important system theoretic concept coming up now, and that is the zero dynamics principle. So when you have a system that's outputting nothing, it can still have some non-trivial internal behavior, right? And so we call that the zero dynamics of the system. That's the well-known concept in system control, right? So the way I'm looking at it here is that we start off by looking at an energy balance relationship. And the equations that I've got here are the equations no longer for the operators, but basically for the envelopes, as we just call them, which underlie the convolutions and Laplace transforms that we have. And so if all of the energy is going to be stored internally, then of course the output must be zero. That means this interval term will be zero. It doesn't mean that the So in this quantum context, what it means is that the output is going to be back here. All right, not just the zero signal. So the zero here that's being captured is the kind of intensity or magnitude of that field. But it's still outputting the back here. Okay. And so what does that imply? Well, we can set the output to be zero. That tells us what the input's got to be. And that gives us the sort of zero dynamics of the system. Okay. So in particular, when we solve for the input, it's going to be this rising exponential. So this is in a more general context here, actually. Okay. So that multivariable compilation is actually very useful for quantum memories. So quantum memories are devices that are intended to store information, quantum information. And so they're hugely important in quantum computing and quantum communication devices. And so we can think about that as we're trying to at least temporarily map optical states onto atomic states, for example. Okay. And so there's a lot of work out there going on about designing repeaters and other components in quantum information systems.
Is there our optical
device? Well, you would have, not necessarily, it could be solid state. Yeah. So some of my colleagues at ANU work with rare earth crystals, and so they try to store input light into the rare earth crystal, for example. So we actually did some work with them some years ago on that. And they have very good progress, and have very long storage times and quite high fidelities. And I'm trying to push them to actually build some circuits in their crystals. I don't think they're quite there yet. I'm not sure they do. Okay. So there
so
is
the
a
atomic way. States, they do what? They take the crystals and they look at the band model of the crystals and try to affect the quantum orbits and all that
stuff. That's right.
And try to
that's
try
right.
the pulse safe. To,
that's right.
How does it hold it?
So they try to.
You can do that, but how do you make sure that it stays there?
They try to map the state onto sort of a nuclear state. So the electrons become an intermediary in that process.
There's no stability of the material getting involved there?
Well, there is, and that's a challenge.
Right.
But with the particular crystals, they do have very long coherent times.
Yeah.
Okay. So here is a multivariable system, and it's got a tunable parameter delta here, which is very important. So when delta is not equal to zero, then the input can access...
Is that the attack
of full system? No.
Yeah.
No, that's maybe I think I'm not sure. So he was a former postdoc, now he's at Canberra University. Yeah. And so he's a very good guy, that's a really good network. So when delta is non-zero, then the field can enter both degrees of freedom, I guess, controllable. And also the output is visible. But when delta is zero, as I've written down in these bottom pair of equations, then that M part is pretty isolated. Okay? So it's like a simplification of what might happen in a quantum memory. But so it's called a decoherence free subspace. And so the idea then can be used to create a quantum memory, right, where you go through a writing stage where we have a perfectly tuned pulse shape coming in. So we have delta non-zero then, and then we turn delta to enter equal zero, and we've got storage, and then when we want to read it out, we turn delta back on again, and then the data will come back out again. So that's the general like the scheme of how quantum memory would work. Okay, so this is just a little slide that shows how how the information may travel through. So this example has got four different degrees of freedom and all shapes of tune. Put the information into location 3 and 4, but not 1 and 2. Okay. So these are the pulse shapes that are required to map the data onto the nodes 3 and 4. Okay. So it's amazing what linear systems theory can do, actually. So all my work that I did with John, I think, was basically all nonlinear stuff, wasn't it? All the work that we did years ago was all nonlinear systems.
All the work we did done, he needed was normalizing everything. It's surprising that I got to know that thing from the quantum.
Okay. That's right. There are lots of nice parallels that way. Okay, so I'll say a few words about
I have a question. To what control, how feasible is to shape the files any way you want? It must be sample
state. Oh, that's what I'll get to that.
It must be sample state, right?
Yeah. I'll show you how we can do that. So I'll go through this next section a little bit quickly, perhaps, so I can get rid of that. I'm recognizing that we're running out of time.
Yeah, fine.
Okay. So one example of wave packet transformations that you would commonly see in quantum optics textbooks, and a lot of times they write things just they don't necessarily take into account the pulse shapes, kind of just have a single mode approximation, basically. But you can see here that if the input has a photon in the two inputs, so beam splitter here has got just a mirror, shining light on the mirror from two different sources, and then you get two output beams coming up. And so if you've got a photon on one beam and a photon on the other beam, so that's in this tensor product notation here. This is an explicit calculation of the alpha field. And you can see here that it's a superposition of various terms. For example, this term means that you've got two photons in the first channel.
Okay. Nearer here is non-transparent or semi-transparent?
Semi-transparent, yeah, that's what I'm trying to do, yeah. Yeah, they can manufacture the mirrors that have different degrees of transmission.
Because you want some of the light, so what
yeah.
Sense do you think?
That's right.
Or
is that's a design parameter. Okay, so I think here was 5050 in that calculation. So we can go through and work out what the output field is going to be more generally, so we have a dynamical system, so the insulator is static, of course. And it turns out that if the input state is maybe some fairly complicated product of sums of various single photon pulses, then the output will be in that form when the system is passive. So a passive system is like a cavity, but when the cavity has an active medium in it, when you pump energy into it, it's no longer passive. Okay. So the proof of this was fairly tricky to do in general, and I did that work with my former postdoc some years ago. But it does involve some careful calculation involving stable inverses of the remember we've got this property that some of the zeros are unstable. Okay, and so what happens in the more general active case? So in the active case, you can create non-trivial Gaussian states from the vacuum. And so that's what this the R means here, so it's like a correlation function. And so what we're getting to here is that we know in the classical world when you have a linear system, when you put in a Gaussian signal, you get a Gaussian signal coming out, right? That's a well-known way to calculate the covariances, right? And so that's what we're getting to here, is that we now have a transformation that involves this process of creation of the Gaussian field as well as the convolutions involved in the wave packet shapes. So we get, well, this formula looks fairly simple. The precise relations were fairly complex. And so that's the general form of the alpha field in that case. And so on the next slide, I think, you can see the transfer relationships. So that bottom one is the usual one that we know for the Gaussian system. And this one is the convolution one.
These are exact here, they're not just second order calculations.
No, these are exact for Gaussian.
From the model.
Yeah, from the model, that's right. So we've never seen any kind of results like that in a typical literature before. Okay. Don't you know, always ask the same questions that we ask. Okay. All right, so this is getting to the question that John was asking about the creation of the wave packets. How do we actually create them? How do we actually shape them? That's kind of where the engineering comes in. So my earlier calculation that I showed you was just like a natural emission, right? But at least mathematically, one way in which we can shape the wave packets is to modulate the strength of the field coupling. And so that's this operator L, which describes that. And so if we modulate the field in this very precise way, so what you see here is the desired wave packet shape, okay? Then if we choose the weighting of that to be this function lambda, then we do get exactly that wave packet shape resulting.
You mean by that, if I write this critical equation, I'll correspond to this trick over there,
yeah? Yeah, if you analyze the system and calculate
the output. If I take the SLH you have there with I lambda D,
yeah.
You know, and
yeah.
I write corresponding critical equation,
yeah.
That would give me that shape.
Yeah, if you analyze the long equation, you'll get that shape. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Why you call it 2D?
Sorry?
Why you call it 2D?
Whereabouts?
Your point is. I'm saying that the two-level qubit system. Fourth line.
Two level. Oh, two level, yeah. So here I'm not considering, I'm just using a like.
No, why you call it qubit?
Because it's a two level system. So here the calculation is done. Yeah, the calculation
that two modes.
Yeah, the calculation showing here is you have a ground state and an excited state.
Thank you.
And that's a qubit. Okay. So that calculation I just showed you on that slide is like a theoretical calculation, but you know in physics it's like a hardly non-trivial thing to do. Because what we want to be able to do is create a wave packet on demand. And so there's a physical process involved in the creation of the energy inside the physical device, and then it has to be released to the environment. And so there's some really nice work, experimental work done by that by Akira Kurosawa and his group in 2013. Remember, in 2014, we were at the Newton Institute in Cambridge, in England, and we were there for several weeks for a special quantum control kind of summer school kind of thing. And we had lots of conversations, and so one of those conversations was, well, why don't you guys, you know, why do you guys always use the same pulse shapes? Why don't you engineer the pulse shapes? So it turned out that he'd done some interesting work on on-demand creation of photons, and then we were able to show, just as you can see here, how you can adapt that to actually shape them precisely. So now he's gone on and done some subsequent work with essentially, you know, engineering the pulse shapes. And so this is actually a good example of feedback. So what's happening here is that we've got two cavities. So this is like the experiment intended to achieve these on-demand photons. So one of them is called the memory cavity, and the other one is called the shutter cavity. And so what happens is that the memory cavity gets some excitation, so you've got to put some energy into it, you eventually want to get some energy out. So that generates pairs of photons. So the tuning of the system is such that one of those pairs escapes immediately into the shutter cavity. So what I mean by immediately is with a very short time constant, and then gets released into the environment, and that can be detected. So it's a heralding event, but that occurs at a random time. So that's a random time. Now, if Td is a time that you want to actually emit your photon, as long as that's larger than the typical values of the heralding time, then you can adjust the storage time. So you adjust the tuning of the cavity after the heralding to kind of store that photon or that excitation inside the memory cavity. So we're just sitting there holding the information. And then you say, okay, well, it took 1 millisecond, so I need to now, and this is 10 milliseconds, I need to hold it for 9 milliseconds. So that's just a simple example of feedback.
That's so how you control the time, but how you control the shape.
Yeah, so you just use the modulation.
Where is the implication in that experiment?
So it's an electro-optical modulator
in there.
Yeah, so that can adjust the tuning characteristics of the activity.
This is electro-optical, meaning with laser?
Yeah, so it's just a, I'm not sure, I don't know the details of how that device works, but it's one of the, I guess they often use crystals inside the cavity for excitation and like that. So this here is a
how far away is this? Okay. We can talk about the end.
Yeah. So
how do you tune the cavity and all that?
Sorry?
How do you tune the MC
So this picture doesn't show all the details, but
okay.
It's a simplification. Yeah, but just a theoretical simplification. I could show you the more complicated
thing. Too slow.
Anyway, so by following that sort of modulation that I was suggesting, then we did some simulations which showed, for example, how you can get a bell curve or a rising exponential.
Okay. So it is modulation, fine, because you have to say that's what you mean by modulation.
That's right.
If one wants to read the details of the physics, that's
interesting. I would be a curious thinker.
Thank you.
Okay. So I'll just finish off with a few words about single-photon filtering. So I've already talked a little bit about filtering theory in general. Okay. So I guess in terms of historical developments, most of the time you see things like Mach equation and things like that, there's always an assumption that the ambient system is in the vacuum, right? And that's kind of a natural assumption to start with, right? Like us using white noise in doing modeling of an engineering system, right? But ultimately, that's like for all our real, you know, cosmology or whatever else it might be. And so I guess in the physics literature, there had been some results determining the Mach equation. Excuse me, when you do have this kind of single photon driving, but there were no results on the filtering. And so we were able to derive the Mach equation using the stochastic calculus. And so now it takes the form of this set of equations. It's not a single equation. So a Mach equation is like a Kolmogorov equation for a different density. But here we need to have a set of four equations. And as engineers, you might guess why, right? You need to have some kind of signal model, right? And so that's what we did. Is that we used a simple model for the creation of the photon, the one that I just showed you a few slides back. And so that now, so now you can see immediately why you get multiple equations, right? Because you get have to have a bigger state space, right? You've got to accommodate the system of interest together with the signal model. So it's like doing common filtering with color noise, right?
Yeah,
and you can add in the dynamics.
Yeah, tensor space, right?
Yeah, and this is all done in tensor power space, that's right. Okay, so anyway, so if you, what you do, so doing this is actually very important because it puts the problem into the correct framework to use the quantum probability ideas, right, conditioning. So if you don't do this kind of converting like this, you don't have the structures that you need to do the filtering. Okay. And so we can calculate the conditional state density expectation for the combined signal model together with the system of interest. And that's what this pi filter means. And then from that, you can extract the conditional expectations for the system of interest. And that's what this pi 1-1 refers to. These are the equations that you get. So it's fairly complicated, and it took us quite a while to sort this out, actually. And so that would be the common filter, if you like, for the. So here the system of interest is a two-level qubit system, and the signal model is also a qubit system. But the principles apply more generally, of course. Okay. So that's what the quantum filter looks like in that context. And so this is a simulation, which I guess this dotted line is the wave packet shape of your input field. This kind of solid line here is the unconditional mean values of the occupation, or the number of probability inside the system. And then the whole swag of random trajectories are conditional trajectories.
Well, you saw these algorithms, right?
So as I said, these ones are conditional.
You cannot really solve dynamics of the true number operator. No, you can simulate it. The number operator, the discrete operator?
You can use the filtering equations to simulate it.
No, I'm asking you.
What are you asking?
They take an algorithm. You're not showing me the number of photons. Because then I should see number variables coming.
Yeah, the average value, that's right.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. So the conditional or
right.
So the way the simulation was done, so this W here is the innovations process.
Yeah.
So that's a white process. And so you just drive the simulation software with that process and then get those projections. Okay. Anyway, so there are a few more things I could say about that. And we also generalize this methodology to be able to deal with input fields that are actually superposition states. So that was also quite complex. Okay, so it's kind of, thank you very much.
Thank you.